important subject, in my opinion, about of in the history of intellectual history and the spiritual history of Lithuanian Jewry, which is not quite commonly addressed, and that is the Muslim movement. If generally, when you say Litvish Jew, you say intellectual, a rabbi, a scholar, that later a maskil. What we often relate with the Litvish Judaism, Litvish Jewry, is the intellectualist idea, which is represented, and quite rightly so. I've not come to refute it, I've not come to correct it. I mean, it is quite true that in Lithuania, following the Gaon and the Chaim Volozhin, the idea was quite that of the learned person, of the Jewish intellectual. Even later on, this idea became modernized through the influence of Daskala. However, during the 19th century, in the course of the 19th century, at least two competing is too strong, but maybe balancing ideals came up. The one is the ideal of the simple Jew, often personified in the figure of the Chafetz Chaim, which I will not address today, and the other one is the ideal of the Musarik, one who works very hard on the perfection of his character, moral improvement, and the ideal of Tikkun HaMidot, moral improvement, is in the center of his life. And this idea was fostered and brought into the forefront by the Muslim movement, who had great influence in the yeshiva world and even beyond that. And it's quite amazing that this movement has not been received yet the sufficient scholarly attention. If we compare it to the vast literature on Hasidism, the competing movement, the opposing movement that has been treated so widely in research, the Muslim movement, we almost I'm sure everyone here heard about Hasidism. No, I'm not sure everyone heard about the Muslim movement. I'm sure some of you at least read something about Hasidism. There's almost no literature about the Muslim movement, although it influenced quite much and also produced quite a great, large literature, quite a rich literature that later influenced the Orthodox thought on the whole, even until these days. This is a Muslim movement that was initiated primarily by Rabbi Israel Salanter, Rabbi Israel Lipkin, known as Saul Salanter, 1810 to 1883. Please correct it here. It's written 1833, it's 1883. Litvish rabbi, himself a scholar, a Talmid Chacham, who felt somehow, a disciple of Reb Chaim Volozhin, who felt somehow that the intellectualist ideals of Litvish Judaism are sometimes even, I would say, even exaggerated, and have to be balanced through something more addressing the moral and the ethical character of the person. His main idea was that Torah learning is very important and we should foster it, and this is also one of the means for human perfection, but also we have to work quite hard on the moral and ethical perfection, which is something that has to be done through kind of psychological exercise. And his exercise, theology is called Musa theology, because he applied, or he turned to the Musa literature, mostly medieval but also more recent to his times, and tried to find there the characterization and the ways to treat human psychological ethical defects. He did so in addressing to books like Chovot al Chovot and Mesilat Yesharim, and directed his disciples to find the defects, the moral defects in it, and try to improve them. How? Basically through a way of what he called learning, Musa learning in enthusiasm, in fervor, in a kind of a lips of flame, as is often quoted, in kind of moral excitement, spiritual excitement. And this, not only that, he also said that we have to cope with the evil inclination that always takes us to sin through practicing the good deeds and trying to get them into kind of habitual behavior and trying to make it as much as we can a part of our more internalized patterns of our personality. The problem that Isolde Sellanta coped with, according to his description himself, was not spiritual one. The problem was not that he didn't seek spirituality per se. He said, basically, all of us are obliged to the halakha, to the mitzvot, to the precepts, but basically, none of us really treat them equally. There are some precepts, some mitzvot, that we treat very adherently and very punctually, and there are some mitzvot which most of us don't take so seriously and actually transgress them even without attention. Such as, he gave the examples, we all are very strict about, said in that time, we're all very strict about kosher, keeping kosher, and Sabbath and other ritual precepts, but on the other hand, we're quite, we take quite easily precepts that are equally, even sometimes more important, like speaking Lashon Hara, speaking gossip, speaking bad things about other people, or even cheating here and there in commerce, or not learning Torah when you have time to, Bitul Torah. These precepts, he said, are something that are things that people tread in their feet, under their feet, and we have to take them more seriously. And the way to achieve this idea of treating all the halakha, all the religious rules equally, he said we have to make it a part of our personality. The idea of fear of God, as he called it, is the one that makes us be more committed to those precepts in an equal manner and not according to our whims, or according to our weaknesses, or according to the expectations of our environment. And this he primarily described in his very, very famous epistle called the Musa letter, Igeret HaMusar. I'd like to read it with you. It's the first text in your handout. The belief, I read the English translation, but there is the Hebrew original on the right side. The belief that the Almighty is the judge, rendering to each man according to his actions, is the beginning step in our service of the Lord. Yet, most unfortunately, this general capacity, meaning our belief, remains hidden within us, concealed in the depths of our hearts. It does not have an external expression unless we till the soil of our hearts through the expansion of the thoughts of Musa from the inner to the outer one. And without that, the power of this general belief does not extend its reach to man's physicality to restrain it within the confines of the fear of God. And the general notion does not entail the particular ones to save them from the sensual or upcoming transgression. And so we succumb to the tremendous sins that reach up to the heavens. If we try to follow Rasul Salanta's words here or directives here, what bothers him is the external realm. We do believe in God, we do really feel committed to the mitzvot, but it does not have external expressions. He doesn't speak about spirituality, certainly not as a goal for itself. His ideal is, let's say, a little bluntly, is a kind of law-observing robot. A person that is fully programmed, I would say, to keep all the precepts equally and in the same level of serious commitment. Now, he does speak about fervent and excited learning and kind of emotional internalization of those ideals of the fear of God and the commitment to the mitzvot. But let's read together another part of this episode, where it speaks about this emotional action, emotional excitement. He says, "Man," this is how the episode begins, "man is free in his imagination and bound by his intellect." And just be aware of that. Imagination is bad. And being bound, being asur, even imprisoned, he would say in the Hebrew word, is good. He is not a kind of freedom-seeking thinker, no. Freedom means being free to sin. We want to be bound by our intellect. His imagination leads him astray in the paths of his heart's desire, so as he does not fear the certain future in which the Lord will punish him for all his deeds and will execute severe judgments upon him. And by the way, Rasul Sellanta, an important thinker as he may be, was a popular preacher who preach to people, to imagine and to portray, to put against their eyes the sins of hell and their punishments in the world to come, and the sins in hell, and sinner's destiny in hell, punishing the world to come in the most picturesque, the most vivid way they can. Imagination, this evil enemy. It is not in our hands. We have the power to repel it by giving an attentive ear to the intellect, so we can understand the truth and measure the reward for the good deed against the punishment of its loss. Yet what can we do? The imagination is an overflowing river, and the intellect will drown unless we place it in the ship, which is the excitement of the soul and the tempest of the spirit. Sol Solata wants to have an excitement of the soul and a tempest of the spirit, but not as a purpose for itself, not as a goal for itself. It's only a means to attain this full commitment to the mitzvot, which is basically, as expressed in the text above, external one. The internal realm is only means for the external one. We have to behave properly, not feel spiritual excitement. This is just the means. We have to behave in our external physicality as we should, as we are ordered by the Torah. And he speaks, it says it even more explicitly in the next text, in number 3. For the fruit of our endeavor, and the Musar endeavor, psychological and educational endeavor, is only to protect our external physicality, to save it from any moral illness, whether of character or in what concerns the observance of the law, of the Torah. And those are not kept in control without moral strength and habitual behavior. Besides, what I said before, besides the emotional excitement in which people have to recite the verses and the sayings of the sages regarding moral improvement, besides those, he gives another exercise, and that is habit. Just habitually behave in the proper way. If, for example, we find ourselves weak in our character trait of generosity, we're not enough generous, one means is just to recite time and again verses about the importance of generosity. The other way is habitual behavior, meaning go and do charity time and again, like until it becomes a part of your internalized character, until it becomes a part of you, if you don't even have a fight with even evil inclinations, you don't have a struggle with evil inclination, it's just a part of your character. And this is just one example. So, in Sol Solata's theology, the interior realm does not find a very important role. It's only a means for the external physical role of performing the mitzvot. Now I'd like to make a little break and speak about the processes that religious movement, not only religious by the way, go through quite often. And in this sense, I'd like to examine the Muslim movement as kind of an interesting exception. You know, Max Weber, one of the founders of modern sociology, wrote, in quite a different context, but it's closely related, about the process of routinization. He spoke about different types of authority or leadership, charismatic, traditional, and rational. And in this sense, he spoke about the fact that sometimes, quite often, what begins is with charismatic leadership later goes through institutionalization and routinization. And first routinization, then institutionalization. And in many religious movements that we go through in history, including Hasidism, by the way, we see that the great fervor, the great enthusiastic period was the first 1, 2, at most 3 generations, and then later maybe it does exist, keep existing in some circles of that movement, but movements that go through a kind of maturation have to get more, become more institutionalized, and basically are more routinized in their relation to their own ideals. What starts with great enthusiasm, of vivid enthusiasm, has to go to go through some stage of routinization. Routinization means making things much more habitual. making things not vividly, but more in a kind of habitual behavior that is much less with emotional emphasis and much more with external emphasis. This is the process that most movements go through. Of course, there are other exceptions to that generalization, but I think this pattern is quite, even prima facie, quite convincing for itself. The Muslim movement, I think, shows quite an opposite, the other way around, the other direction, an opposite direction of development. The beginning of this movement in Lithuanian Jewry was, as we saw right in these three texts above, was much more habitual, much more seen in favor of the routineous and habitual exercise of the mitzvot, the much more external ideals. And quite amazingly, I would say, third generation, which we should expect this routinization and institutionalization, in the Muslim movement, third generation is rather the opposite. The third generation seeks spirituality, seeks the vivid and much less routineous exercise of the mitzvot. And Stas and others, disciples, went and founded New Yeshivot, known as Musa Yeshivas. Actually, the second generation of Musa movement is the generation of variety in the Musa theology. It became very varied, ranging from the right wing, the loud extreme, which is a very radical one, and created a kind of Musa, I think, kind of Orthodox freaks in some way, going against all conventions and trying to really break many rules of expected behavior in their fight for Musa improvement, moral improvement, down to the more optimistic and humanistic Slobodka school, and in the middle of the Kelm school, which was much more emphasized the ideals of discipline and self-respect and even some kind of theological inquiry as Musarist ideal. The third generation, mostly in the Kion school, was of a few thinkers that developed the Musar into much broader and more interesting ideals. And one of them, the one I would like to focus on today, is Rabbi Yeruchom Lvovich of Mir, often pronounced as Lvovich. It's wrong, it's Lvovich, as the Yiddish spelling shows. But if you say Lvovich, maybe you won't know who you're talking about, so you should be equally familiar with his name as Yeruchom Lvovich. Anyway, Rabbi Yeruchom of Mir, who is a disciple of the Alter of Kiern, I mean, he's a disciple of this Kiern school, which I mentioned before. But he took the Kelm school theology to quite different and quite refreshing directions. In the Musa movement, in the development of the Muslim movement, I think Rabbi Yeruchom of Mir is the one that more than anyone else represents the idea of spirituality, not as means, but as goal for itself, as purpose for itself. And the excitement and the religious awareness and the in developing the internal world of the world of the person as religious ideals, much more than many other thinkers in his time, and much more than many even Hasidic thinkers of that time, when Hasidism was much more orthodox and a mainstream movement. And in many ways, the Yeruchom Lvovich shows an opposite direction, not routinization, but routinization. And it's not only that, but he even fights the idea of routine. He doesn't mention it in the same word, because he can't really go against the founder of his own movement. So that doesn't speak against habit, but he does speak against routineous behavior. In Hebrew, hergel is the word for habit, the one used in positive sense by Rabbi Salanter. The Yeruchom of Mir does not attack hergel, he attacks the melumada, of performing the mitzvot anashim melumada in a routineous manner. And this is actually the same thing as again, but in another word, which is easier for him to attack. And also, another word that he mentions quite, I think, in a surprising way, the word Funkheit, any orthodox circle, Funkheit meaning observance or deep punctilious, frequent of the mitzvot, or punctilious observers of the mitzvot. In Orthodox circles, generally mentioned in a positive way, he mentions it quite negatively. Funkeit is for him something that is showing of narrow-minded, keeping of the mitzvot without really emotional or a spiritual interest. He speaks. Let's read together source number four. He says, "One should not act in a way of mere Funkeit, for the wind will come and scatter him as chaff. Man's toil should be in the way of sowing, doing all his deeds so they are rooted within him, and only thus will he succeed to bear fruit." And against Funkeit, he suggests the idea of encounter with God, even really kind of really religious experience in some way, and he even relates it to the literature ideal of Torah learning. He says, basically, Torah learning should bring us to encounter with God, to some kind of religious experience. And we see so many yeshiva students studying and learning the word of God and Torah, and not coming to that encounter, and not coming to that spirituality. And this should be puzzling. It shouldn't be so. The Torah is the word of God. That is what should bring us to this spiritual excitement and spiritual awakening. The rabbis said, where there is no Torah learning, there is no fear of God. And where there is no fear of God, there is no Torah learning. It's in a whole. The word yirah, fear, which is the idea of the Muslim movement, comes from the word ra'ah, see. For the essence of the fear of God comes from seeing. When one sees the Creator, one necessarily fears Him. Of course, this seeing is not what we imagine in the daily sense, as in the physical sense. It is an intellectual seeing, but nevertheless, it is seeing, without which the fear of God does not exist. Now, the whole essence of the Torah is a locus to see the Almighty immediately, face to face. The Torah is called the garment of God. In each letter and each part of the Torah, His existence is woven. All his actions and attributes are embedded in the Torah. When a person learns the Torah of God, is immediately perceived by his creations. The knowledge of God comes particularly from Torah learning. Now, the phenomenon of a person who learns the Torah and does not know God is one of the greatest wonders, and already the prophet expresses his amazement at it. They that handle the law, that is, who learn and practice it, knew me not, Jeremiah says. What are the moral deficiencies that separate between the two? The prophet, once again, Isaiah, says, therefore the Lord said, for as much as people draw near to me with their mouth and their lips do honor me, but have removed their heart from me, and their fear for me is taught by the precept of men. That's how the King James Version translates it, but generally in Hebrew, here comes the words mitzvata nashim l'umada, which is actually, and the fear of me is but practicing the precepts routinely. This is how it's often translated, was interpreted. And therefore, behold, I will proceed, and then says the prophet, the outcome is the loss of wisdom. If you practice the mitzvot routinely, it causes the loss of wisdom. The routinous practice of the mitzvot is apparently the great deficiency that is capable of separating the Torah from God. But from the point of view of the real nature of the Torah, that is absolutely inconceivable. For already from the first letter of the Torah, it is necessary to encounter the Lord, blessed be He. So, the woman of Mir, in the third generation, as I said, goes the other way around. Not more institutionalized manner in the type of Moshe, but rather more spiritual, more vivid, more fervent, more kind of a religious experience seeking. And if the ideal of halacha, observing of halacha, which Rav Soloveitchik represents, is a kind of more general idea, everyone should keep the mitzvot at the same level and the same code of the mitzvot should be kept by everybody equally. And the ideal is creating, as I said, is creating some kinds of halacha observing robots. But Yochanan is much more aware of people's individuality. So Sansa as well is aware of people's individual character. But once again, the level of the means, we're all with different characters, so we all have to educate ourselves in different ways and try to find, each one has to find his own individual deficiencies and correct them. But the ideal per se, the ideal itself, is a general universal ideal, Jewish universal ideal of Torah observance. On the other hand, Rabbi Yochanan presents something that may be at least interpreted as kind of individualist idea. He says, man is the himself, this is how he calls it, that is the inner essence. And any movement against the internal nature, especially in the outer level, is man's escaping himself, and outward departure from himself. And this is not quantifiable, for everyone, it's in a different way. For he can depart from himself without measure until he loses himself altogether. And thus, he wanders around without a place nor a status, and has no hold in anything. And this is the meaning of the words of the Torah. You haven't seen the Lord, etc., etc. And the Lord has not given you a heart to perceive, and eyes to see, and ears to hear unto this day. Namely, after all the sights that you have seen, you still haven't attained the degree of being yourselves, or having a heart to perceive, and eyes to see, etc. And this is the essence of the repentance. In Hebrew, repentance, tshuva, is from the word return, teshuv. To return to oneself, to one's internal being, to one's organs. And that is the meaning of Hillel's saying in Avot, if I'm not for myself, who is for me? Which means to attain the degree of being oneself. So, Ruchov from here is not only developing an idea of spiritual internal experience, but also an idea of individual Musarist character. Not one and a generally universal idea, but each one should take his own character and try to develop it in the way that takes the best out of it individually. In this way, as I said, Sol Salanter is quite staunch and beautiful, while Rabbi Yochanan goes to much more individualist course, and much more than this. The Muslim movement becomes an example, for example, a case for quite interesting direction of development, not from the spiritual, fervent movement to the institutionalized and routineous one, but one that goes from habit, from the institutionalized form and the more routineous form, to the more vivid spiritual heart. As he said, the heart is in the center, the interior is in the center, goes the other direction for most of the religious movements that we often meet. This is one thing that makes the Muslim movement a very interesting case for study. I hope it evoked your appetite to know more about.